Good evening, everybody. So I will be your moderator for the evening. My name is Alice Petway, and I'm a poet and writer myself. But tonight, this is about these four amazing writers that we have from China, Slovenia, and Portugal. So I'd like to first introduce you to them, and then we'll get started with the discussion.
大家晚上好，我是今天的主持人，我叫 S， 我自己也是一位诗人和作家，但是今天晚上我们要主要要讨论的就是这四位来自于斯洛文尼亚、葡萄牙以及中国的作家。那么首先我会对他们做一个简短的介绍，再开始今天的讨论。So
I'll introduce the writers in the order they're seated here. First, Aleš Šteger. Aleš Šteger is a poet and prose writer based in Ljubljana, Slovenia. His work has been widely translated and has appeared in internationally renowned magazines and newspapers as The New Yorker, The Boston Review, Neue Zürcher Zeitung, Süddeutsche Zeitung, TLS, and many others. The Bavarian Academy of Arts awarded him with the International Bienek Prize for Poetry in 2016, calling him, quote, one of the most original European poets writing today. Among other prizes and honors, his English translation of the Book of Things won two major U.S. translation awards, the BTBA Award and AATSEL. He received the title Chevalier des Arts et Lettres from the French state and is a member of the Berlin Academy of Arts. Aleš was the first international writer in residence at the Chinese Research Center of Capital Normal University in Beijing in 2014. And he has also lectured at Sichuan University. Aleš's work reaches out to various fields of artistic expression. He has worked in the field of visual arts and has had several collaborations with musicians and film directors. In Chinese translation, IPPH Publishing House in Beijing published his poetry collection, Einstein's Tower, in 2014. His prose book, Berlin, will be published in Chinese translation in spring 2018 by East China Normal University Press. That is a very impressive bio. I'm excited to hear what he has to say.
Okay, 那我就按照我的作家们坐在我身边的顺序来介绍他。首先呢，我们要介绍 Aleš。 Aleš是一位居住在斯洛文尼亚首都卢布尔雅纳的诗人和散文作家。 他的作品广被翻译，并出现在国际知名的期刊和报纸上，比如《纽约客》、《波士顿评论》、《新苏黎世报》、《南德意志报》等。巴伐利亚艺术学院授予他2016年国际赏奖诗歌奖，称他是当今在创作中最具独创性的欧洲诗人之一。在众多奖项和荣誉中，《事务之书》的英文译本为他获得了两项重要的美国翻译类奖项。 他获得了法国政府授予的艺术与文学骑士奖项，并且是柏林艺术学院的成员之一。在2014年，艾勒什成为了北京首都师范大学中国研究中心地位住校的国际作家。他还在四川大学讲学。艾勒什作品涉及到艺术表达的多个领域，他在视觉艺术领域也颇有成就，与音乐家、导演都有合作。至于中文译本，北京的知识产权出版社在2014年出版了他的诗集《爱因斯坦的塔》。 他的散文集面包与玫瑰，柏林故事的中译本将于2018年春天由华东师范大学出版社出版。不得不说，这是一个令人非常印象深刻的个人履历。And
then here to the right, we have José Luís Peixoto. José is one of Portugal's most acclaimed contemporary novelists. He has received several Portuguese and international literary awards, such as the José Saramago Literary Award in 2001 for best novel published in all Portuguese-speaking countries in the two previous years. Libro de Europa, best novel published in Europe in 2012, and Oceanos Literature Award, best novel published in all Portuguese-speaking countries in 2015. His novels are translated into 26 different languages. So, also very excited to hear what you have to say this evening.
那么我们下一位作家呢是José，José是葡萄牙当代最负盛名的小说家之一。他获得了一些葡萄牙国内和国际上的文学奖，如2001年的José Saramago 文学奖，前两年在所有葡萄牙国家中出版的最佳小说，Libro de Europa 和Oceanos 文学奖。 他的小说已经被译成26种语言，所以今天有你在场也非常令人欣喜激动。
And then next to the right, here we have Xiao Bai. Xiao Bai, a member of the Shanghai Writers Association, took up writing in the strict sense in 2005. He has published 2 novels, Game Point and French Concession, which has been sold into many markets abroad, including the US, the UK, France, Germany, Italy, and Holland. He also published a novella, The Agent, Mr. Xu, which won the 10th Shanghai Literature Award, and 2 anthologies of essays, Erotic Hamlet and Acting versus Peeping. Erotic Hamlet captured a comic touch in ancient and contemporary erotic texts as well as images, which was brought to full play by forging an academic narrative in an ironic way. It won 2009 Book of the Year, organized by New Weekly. Welcome.
小白他是一位上海专业的作家，然后他从2005年起从事长期的译创作，刊发于各种各样的杂志，上有非常多的文章，然后他有第一部长篇指典发表在《生活》《曾参2008年春夏卷》上，然后他的作品呢在各个地方引起了非常大的反响，在国比如说书界，在国内外文坛均引起了热烈反响，入选小说引力华文国际互联平台选出的华文20部长篇小说之一。
And last but certainly not least, we have Zou Zou, who is a professional literary editor and self-professed amateur storyteller. Who is the author of a number of novels. She believes that language is the most essential element in literature and focuses much attention on the sophistication of human nature and motives. Welcome. Okay, so this is the wonderful group we have with us, and I think we should get straight to the discussion. And I know that everyone's aware the title of the session tonight is Why We Write. Which is pretty broad, and I would encourage all of our panelists to take these questions in whichever direction suits you. And I will keep the door open, so I'll let you get the conversation for the most part.
Okay, 最后一位介绍作家是走走，他是一位专业编辑，也是一位专业的小说家。那么他说呢，他觉得文学最关键的部分就是语言，那么在其中最关键的部分还有人性的复杂。 那么接下来呢，我们将要进入这个讨论的关键部分。那么在这个讨论中呢，因为这个讨论的主题它是我们为什么写作，所以它是一个比较广的话题。但我希望大家在说的过程中可以把这个话题放到最适合你的方向来说。Maybe
we can start by saying that everyone sitting here is clearly an extremely successful writer. You all have made it. There's such a thing. But when you are deciding whether to be a writer or not, that's far from certain, and you're forced at some point to make a choice if you're going to devote your life to the pursuit of literature. How did each of you make that decision if this was something you wanted to spend your life doing? Maybe Aleš, we can start with you.
No, in my case, I'm sorry, Aleš, maybe you can translate. 那首先第一个问题呢，就是我知道在座的各位都是非常成功的作家，但是其实在最初的时候，你们并不知道你们将会成为成功的作家。那么是什么在最初的时候促使你们做出这样一个选择，要把写作作为一种事业呢
？Hello, everyone. I was growing up in the countryside. In a region in Central Europe where if you drive in one direction 2 hours, no one speaks your language, my language anymore.
大家好，我生活在乡下，成长在乡下，它在中欧的一个地方。那这个地方呢是这样的，如果你沿着这个地方一个方向开车2个小时的话，你会发现那边的人们再也不和你，再也不和我说同一种语言了。
language, and I felt this already as a child, was not something that was given automatically. It was a fragile thing, and it was something that one would have to be cautious about.
那语言，我从小时候就有这样一种感觉，它不是自动赋予在你身上的，它是一个脆弱的东西，你需要谨慎地对待它。
The fragility of language, that language can be lost, and that is, on the other hand, composed out of sediments of what others have lost, perhaps. It was deep in, embedded in my childhood experience.
语言的脆弱性以及语言可以丢失的这个特点。
When we write, we are not speaking our own language. We are speaking the language of the unknown, a language that has to be found and constructed. So there is a notion, at least for me, of being a foreign speaker of a language that I haven't found yet while I'm writing.
那当我们写作的时候呢，它并不是在说一种语言，它并不是在表达一种语言，它这种语言是我们不断在寻找却没有找到，不断的需要去建构、去寻找的这样一个东西。 那作为一个外语的这样一个写作者呢，我为什么要写作？其实我还没有找到这样一个原因。
On the other hand, what made me write was not so much the writing itself; it was reading.
那另一方面，为什么我要写作呢？其实它并不和写作十分相关，它和阅读更相关。
When I was 15 approximately, by accident or by faith, I got across a book. It was a poetry book by Octavio Paz, and this book changed my life.
那大概我15岁的时候呢，不知是偶然还是因为我的某种信念，我遇到了一本书，这本书改变了我的生活。
It was a book translated into my language, which was carrying basically a different way of thinking in images, and I was so fascinated, so taken by it, that I knew that's what I would like to do. My life.
那这本书呢，是翻译成我的这种语言的这种阅读体验是如此不同，它让我采用图像的方式去思考，如此的吸引我，于是我开始做和以前不一样的事情。
Since we are, I am a foreigner when I write, there must be a necessity doing this. There must be a necessity trying to follow something that we call inspiration.
那因为我在写作的时候，我是一个外国人，所以跟随灵感是有必要的。
Must be a deep drive doing it, and it's not. One shouldn't take it for granted that this is always given, first, and second, that everything that we write should also be published. I'm actually skeptical about it. I think one should have a decent attitude towards this and be the harshest critic of oneself.
那在这其中呢，一定是有一种推动力在推动着的，所以我们不应该把灵感当成理所当然的事情，我们不应该认为灵感都是自动赋予的。然后第二点呢，就是我觉得写的东西不一定都是要出版的，人们对于出版物要抱有一种怀疑的态度。
José, how about you? How did you discover you were a writer?
Hello, good evening, everybody. Well, since Aleš started talking about childhood, I think I will go back to that time also. Since my story with writing as I believe it happened with most people, it started there. Also, considering the fact that my family background and is maybe a bit exotic seen from Shanghai. I mean, it's really different from the kind of childhood one would have in Shanghai, because I'm from a village of 1,000 inhabitants. In the place I was born lives 1,000 people.
大家好，很高兴见到大家。既然Aleš谈到了他的童年，那么我也会回到童年谈论我的写作动机。就像我觉得所有的人其实都是从童年开始有写作这种感觉的。那么因为我的家庭背景它是一个抑郁的家庭背景，这种家庭背景肯定和比如说上海的家庭背景它是不同的，因为我生长在一个小的村庄里，这个小的村庄里只有1000个人。
Setting is very important in my books because it's very important for me. My first approach to reading books was not so easy, because back there was not many, there were not many books around. And so I became a reader by what we call an itinerant library, which was a sort of a small truck that would arrive once a month and park in the main square, and it was and it brought books, and we were able to go there and take 4 books per month, and the next month we would return them and get 4 more.
那么在我的写作经历中呢，书籍对我很重要。我最开始的时候成为读者的这样一个经历，其实并不是一个非常可得的一个荣誉的经历，因为在我小时候呢，书并不是很多，然后我并不是一个非常能够读到很多书的这样一个人。那我会说，我小时候接触到的图书馆就像一个流动的图书馆，它一个月会过来一次，比如说停在我的广场上面，然后大家呢就去借书。那时候。 比如说一个月借4本书，然后下一个月呢，这个车又会过来，然后我就把4本书还掉，再借下面4本书。
So it took me a while to lose this distance between me and books, because books were something that were out of my environment. My great parents, both my father's parents and my mother's parents, could not read or write. And that's also very important for me, because it tells a lot about where I come from. I during my childhood or my teenager years, I never ever imagined that I would be a writer. And I would never ever imagine that one day I would be talking about my writing in Shanghai.
那所以呢，他花了我很多的时间来拉近我和书的距离，因为在我的生活环境中是没有书的。另外呢，我的祖父母、我的外公外婆和爷爷奶奶，他们都既不会阅读，也不会写字，这对我来说也非常重要，因为它说明了我的生活背景，我的成长背景。 所以呢，其实我从来没有想到过，我之后会成为一个作家。在我小时候，在我10几岁的时候，我也从来没有想到过有一天我会在上海谈论我为什么写作。But
first reading and then writing became very important for me. I developed a very personal world around it in my teenager years, but I never thought that I would be a professional writer. I always imagined that I would be a teacher. That was for me a more reasonable profession, because I did not know anybody who lived out of writing. That was completely out of my world. Then I studied in university. I graduated. I was a teacher for 4 years,
and then I published my first novel. I got that big award that you mentioned, and that allowed me to be a professional writer after I was 26 years old.
那所以呢，我其实从来没有想过到想到过会成为一个作家。其实我之前是想成为一个老师的，因为我从来没有认识一个人，任何一个人能够可以专门靠写作为生。他在我的世界，在我的生活环境之外的一个东西。但是后来呢，我就读了大学，然后我毕业了，我确实当了几年的老师，然后再接着呢，我又出版了小说，获得了你刚刚提到的那个大奖，然后再之后呢，是他成让我成为了一个专业的作家。
My mother was very worried when I became a professional writer, when I gave up teaching. And also I was a bit anxious. And since then I have always been a bit obsessed in overcompensating and trying to make this profession real and also to get some money out of it.
当我成为职业作家之后呢，我妈妈非常的担心。其实我也有点担心，所以后来呢，我就做了很多的努力去弥补这种担心，希望我想把我这个职业作家这个工作变得更真实一点。然后我也努力的从这个职业中去赚钱。
And in terms of a writer's life, I think there are two important things to consider. If one is a professional writer, is the career, which is the practical part of being a writer. You know, having something that pays your bills and doing certain things to get certain rewards. But then there is another part, which is in fact the reason of everything, which is the body of work. And throughout the years, you are building a career and at the same time a body of work. Or maybe I should say you're building a body of work, and because of that you're also building a career.
那么在你把写作当做生活的时候呢，它有两个非常重要的点。首先呢，它是因为一项职业，所以它有它现实的一部分。比如说我看到有付账单的这样一部分。那么另外一部分呢，就是你把它作为一个工作的本体。所以在一年一年的过程中，你在尊重职业的这样一个过程中，你建立了一个工作的主体，或者我也可以反过来说，你在建立工作主体的这一个过程中，建立了你的职业。
Sometimes I notice that people make a confusion between these two concepts. They talk about the career when they are intending to talk about the body of work. But I mean, they're really easy to separate, even if they influence themselves. There is influence between these two dimensions. But still, I think that one has to pay attention to both, because they are both important. I mean, we may say, the body of work is more elevated than the career. But I mean, if you don't eat, how can you do a body of work? If you don't have the conditions to create, how will you create? So in the end, they are in fact indissociable. But of course, I feel that what gives, if one has ambitions in writing, most times thinks about the career and the good things that come with the career, with the success in the career. But of course, what gives justification to everything, what's in fact the center of everything, is the body of work.
那么我在有的时候呢，会发现人们会混淆这两种概念。比如说，有的人会混淆，你不知道哪种是职业，什么是你的工作的主体。但是我觉得这两者是非常容易区分的，它会带来某些影响，而这些影响是比较容易辨认的。
那么我知道人们有的时候并不注意它，但是我觉得人们应该更多的关注它，因为这两种东西都是非常重要的。首先呢，你这样一个工作，你的工作的主体，它看起来其实更加高大一点，它好像是比职业更加高大上一些。但是我觉得职业也是非常重要的。比如说，如果你不吃饭的话，那么你怎样建立工作的主体呢？ 如果你没有这样一个创作的环境的话，你又怎样去创作呢？所以这两者它是不可分的。当人们在用心写作的时候，当人们在用心创造的时候，其实这个时候也就是在创造他的工作的主体，创造他的职业了。
What was there a particular moment when you knew that you would spend your life writing?当时是什么促使你走上写作之路的呢？
我们为什么写作的终极性的问题，跟不是谁一样。但其实可以分两个部分来讲啊，一个就是你刚才问我的，就是你怎么走上写作到这种偶然的日常的职业性的，你怎么会写作的？你要看吗？还是你继续往下说？啊，就是这个很简单，是我不是我去找他的，是他来找我的。 写作这件事情是他自己来找我，我就在家坐着，然后有编辑说，哎，你帮我写一点东西，然后就写，写着写着就写了，很简单。
那，Sally just asked me why do you choose writing? I think the theme why do we write is the ultimate question, ultimate problem, and it can be divided into two parts. The first part is the question you just asked, and you just mentioned that what kind of accidents that lead me to the way of writing. And I think the answer is very easy. I don't seek writing. The writing is seeks me by itself. Sometimes I sit at home and someone asks me to write, then I begin to write. It's just that easy.
因为我干某一件事情，一定存在某一个必然性。那这个宿命般的，你为什么会写作？你为什么最终会写作？这可能，那我也得总结总结。那我觉得这个，我觉得，这其实跟你这个人身上是哪一种类型的，你存在某一种方面，因为人都有他特长的天赋的，也有他不行的方面。我觉得一个写作的人可能。 因为你从小就一定会是一个幻想的，试图成为别人，试图通过某种方式进入别人的生活，或者表演别人的生活，这样一种天性或者天赋。我觉得是这样，因为我自己感觉，比方我很小的时候，那我的记不清几岁了，反正非常小，大概两三岁、三四岁的样子。 不超过5岁，就整天在家里，不管幼儿园、托儿所还是家里，反正整天就在做一个白日梦，就是听天白日的，我就开始一个人在脑子里构想一个那种一道菜，一个人躲在一个完全自成一个体系的一个密道里，然后我会设想，哎，我要。 但敌人不知道，有时候是日本鬼子，反正德国鬼子，反正很多敌人。这个不管看当时境，反正就是你会去，我会去设想，哎，我需要准备干它几年在这个地方里啊，3年我要准备多少粮食，吃的，我会设想，哎，我是不是需要几个伙伴？然后我会想，哎，不行，如果我跟他同样喜欢一块巧克力的话，也无法办得挺麻烦。 反正我就设想了很完整一个故事，会把这个故事连续几个小时把这个故事会想得非常非常完整，实际上就设计了整个的一个系统，但它没有发展，没有时间发展。但是我觉得这，就是你从小就有一种想进入另外一种生活的这样一个能力，我觉得这可能是跟你后来会写作是有点关系，知道吗？它的而且我。 我后来实际上我在后来的阅读当中，我查阅到一份档案，在后来写作当中，一个第二次世界大战时期在苏联的那解密的情报档案中，我看到说在奥德赛那个地方有一个，因为奥德赛是那个。
那个沙皇，当时造皇宫的时候，在那边挖了很多大理石，所以地下是水，都很多的这个空洞，非常非常非常大，绵延几百公里的这样一个地下的通道。然后在二战时期，就有一支游击队在里面生活了好长时间。 然后果然不出我三岁时候走掉，因为那次游击队大概有七八个人在里面，后来就相互的，有的变成精神病，有的是因为这个食物和弹药够分配，互相残杀，最后没有一个活活着出来。我觉得我看这个材料，我三岁时候就想过，不要跟人打架，我一个人在里面生活，各种粮食零食，蛮好。
Those people who write and writing must be very imaginative since they are very young. The former point I talked about the accidental thing that lead you to writing, and now I want to talk about the necessities that lead you to writing. Because when people write, you always think there is something like a fate that you are destined to write, and writing is your art. So here I want to summarize it, and it's very related to your genius, what you are good at and what you are bad at. So let's talk about imagination. So I think people who want to become writers must be very imaginative, and they will imagine that how they will be like if they are the other one, and how they have gone to the other one's life and play the role in the other one's life. When I was young, I think I didn't remember how young I was, but it must be like 3 or 4 years old. No matter it's in the kindergarten or at home, I always play the night daydreams. And at that time, I would imagine that I would fight in the tunnel with the enemies. And the enemies, I don't know, they may come from Germany, or they may come from Japan. And I fight it with them like 3 years. And I would imagine that how much food do I need in 3 years, and would I need pals to fight with me against the enemies? But later I thought, no, I would not need the pals, because if they stayed with me, they would fight with me for the chocolates. I don't want to share chocolates with the other pals. And I designed a complete story by myself. I would spend hours designing the story, and I designed the whole system. But I don't have the time to develop that story. So that was my story. This was my life when I was very young. And later, I read some archives that is unsecreted from the Soviet Union in the World War II. That is in Odyssey, the place where the Tsar built his palace. And among the marbles, under the marble floors, there were very big tunnels. And it turned out that in the tunnels of 700 kilometers, in the World War II, there was a troop living in the tunnels for a very long time. And there were 7 to 8 soldiers. And some of them turned in stay in the tunnels. And some of them fought for food and fought for the other army things in the tunnel. And they killed themselves, killed each other, and no one came out of the tunnel alive. So I think, yes, I thought about everything that really happened later when I was only 3 years old.
另外我觉得就是你当然光有想象力是不够，你还要有一个，我觉得写作归根结底跟那个演员在舞台上表演是一样，是或者是同样一个事情，就是实际上写作也是从哪里来的？因为我们知道写作是从讲故事的传统来的。 讲故事这个传统，实际上就是一个人在很多观众前面表演，讲一段故事啊，或者跳一段大神，对吧？以前的故事时代，就不管什么样，就是它实际上一个人对很多人的一个表演。我觉得写作的一个重要的一个，你可以说是能力、天赋，也可以说是你的宿命，就是你肯定是除了你的想象力、同情心，还有一个你进入别人的生活。 表演别人生活的这样一种能力，如果你有了这样几种天性或者天赋或者能力，你就坐在家里写作是会来自你的自己。
So I think, except for
great imagination for a person. I think writing is very important, and writing equals to performance sometimes, because there is a traditional story for writing. When you are telling stories, it's like you are showing in front of a big audience in ancient times. So it's like when you are telling stories, you're just a presence show to a large audience. So I think the capability of writing is very important. And except for, of course, when you write, you need imagination, you need thinking, and also the capability of you entering the other's life and performing other's life.
Was there a particular moment for you? Was there something that perhaps happened or something you read that led you to start writing?
那最后想问一下早早，有没有一些特定的时刻，有没有这些特定发生的事情，或者你特别读到的一些东西，让你走上写作之路呢？
刚才三个作家都是用了一个顺序的方式，从童年进入讲自己的写作之路，所以我现在用一个倒叙的方式，就从现在开始往回溯。我从去年年底从上海作家协会跟我工作了十几年的生活文学杂志辞职创业。 然后我们公司做的是，我可以用对技术的术语，比如说 NLP 自然语言处理、语义分析依赖、无监督学习算法等等 LDA 主题建模。我们简单来说是用人工智能来阅读小说跟理解小说。那我可以告诉大家一个结论，就是最开始你们会觉得有科幻小说、有推理小说、有所谓的纯文学作品，其实计算机读出来。 所有的小说只有两种，可以回溯到古希腊的喜剧跟悲剧。所有的小说只有两个图形，一个是 W， 一个是 M， 这是标准的小说。它们相当于你想象一下是火柴棍拼出来的世界。我拿掉 M 的话，我拿掉第一根，是一个 N； 我拿掉后面一根，这个人的结局是不错的。如果是 W 也一样，把第一根拿掉，把最后一根拿掉。 所有的小说的变体就是这些。我们读了门罗的小说，大家想象不到吧？门罗的很多小说是符合这样一个曲线，也就是说，它极其之工整，它甚至于是对称的。基本上，在小说的一半的时候，人物到了一个，它可以做选择的高点，然而最终宿命一定会让他做一个错误的选择，推向他开始沦落，或者说沦向他的黑暗，比如说陶笛里那些作品。 而且我们会发现，作品小说跟建筑跟画画一样，它的一个对称系数是非常完整的，它可能是这样的对称，它也可以是反向的对称，它是就正向对称跟反向对称两种。所以我们现在建模分析这个对称系数。所以回过头来，如果所有的小说，所有非常自我的，我相信所有的作家写作的时候都是非常自我。 认为我的叙述是与众不同的，认为我讲述了一个完全不一样的世界，认为我所有的对于喜怒哀乐、对于忧伤、对于绝望的描述是我个人化的。那么很抱歉，今天我用计算机的方式来观看小说，那就是这么两种。我们还读了，其实我读一些文章，在50年代，上世纪50年代，前苏联就已经用 AI 人工智能写小说，那个AI是读了很多的。 托尔斯泰的小说，我们甚至可以在他一段文本里面认识出、识别出战争与和平的语言风格。所以回到为什么我当时写作，今天我就像一个在宇宙上的人，看这个地球一样，觉得非常渺小。那么我觉得当时的我是因为孤独，也因为要一个自我表达，想要确定。 自我在这个世界里面短暂的存在，所以才会想写作，你想被别人看到，你想去影响别人。那从今天我又抽身而出来，我再去观察我写的世界，会发现非常渺小。你所谓你追求的真相，不管是追求自己的真相，还是追求一个政治性的、社会性的真相，其实都只有人的命运，也就命运这一种解释。而这个命运本身，从地球的历史来讲。 从宇宙的角度来讲，也是非常非常渺小的。我只能说，所有就是我自己写作，我觉得像一个西西弗推石头。如果在我生命没有结束，还在写作的时候，它就是一个向上的。
So the last three writers introduced their experience from their childhood while they write. Now I want to go back, take a direction that's very different from them. And when I write, before I was editor writer in the Harvest magazine, and I resigned from there, and I work with the other colleagues in the modeling of the literature, and we use some artificial methods to read novels and to understand novels. And when you read novels, you may see some are science fiction, some are deduction detective novels, and some are pure literature. But when they are understood by the artificial machines, it turned out there are only two novels, two kinds of literature, and that is very similar to the Greek, ancient Greek literature. They are divided into comedies and tragedies. And they have different models. Some are like W models and some are like M models. And when you take the stroke in the left or you take the stroke on the right, W models and the M models, they are very similar. That is, if you separate them in the middle, the left part and the right part, they are very the same. And so, for example, you read the novel of Monroe, and you see it has a very clear structure, but it always works like that. In some moment of story, the protagonist is faced with a choice, and he or she will certainly make the wrong choice and lead him or her to decay. For example, the novel Run Away. So you write a novel, it's very like a build a model, or it's very like you draw something. It's always, if you separate them in the middle, the left part and the right part, they are the same. All the novels are like that. And when all the novelists, they write, they think they're very different. They think they're unique because they build characters. Sometimes they're happy, sometimes they're angry, and sometimes they're desperate. They think their emotions are individual, are unique, singular. But now the artificial intelligence tells them that it's not, they're the same. And in the 15 years of in the 1950s in Soviet Union, they have already used artificial intelligence to write novels. And the machines have read the novels of Tolstoy. For example, they read Peace and War, and they even can recognize the language style of Peace and War. And talk about why do I write? When I see from the universe, I think the Earth is very small and I am a so humble human being existence. So that's why I write. I feel very lonely and I want to express myself. I want to use what I know to put it into the real life and to influence people. But till now, today, when I look back and why do I write, I feel still very humble. Whatever truth you seek after, the truth of human beings, the truth of things, or the truth of politics of the societies, they are the truth, but they are also decided by the fate, as it's the only explanation of the fate. And on the earth, in the universe, we are still very humble. So this is explanation that why do I write? And also, I feel like that I'm like Sisyphus pushing a stone up on the slope. And when I am still alive, I will push and make it upward. But when everything is over, it will fall down and will fall on my body. So that's my understanding.
So let me check our time. Because everybody answered so beautifully and thoroughly, we actually are a little bit short on time. So what I'd like to do is try to get through one more question, but if we could all keep it a little bit on the brief side, that way everybody has time to answer. And maybe we could this time start down with you, Zou Zou, since you had to wait to the last, the first question. So we've heard how all of you decided to become writers, but
I know that that path, once you've chosen it, is never completely easy. And I'm sure that you've all faced challenges along the way. Maybe you could tell me about a particularly challenging point where you questioned your decision whether you should be a writer after all, and how you moved past that challenge.
那我希望接下来的回答呢，大家可以稍微简短一点，这样的话我们可以不提出几个问题来。那么下一个问题呢，就是因为我们之前谈到了是什么促使你们决定踏上作家之路的，大家的路都非常的不容易。那么接下来呢，我们知道在这条路上都会面临各种各样的挑战，那么你们各自都面临过怎样的挑战呢？
我觉得我最早就是从自己的本能来写自己熟悉生活的时候是没有遇到过挑战的，然后挑战是发生在之前，就是我写延安时期的那些知识分子的命运，就是他们从在延安时期的一些选择和他们建国后的一些命运，然后想把他们跟历史上的人物结合起来。我当时写的主题是想写胡风。 大家可能不是很了解，反正就是一个是写相当于就是写了一首诗歌，然后因此获罪的一个人，然后因此还牵连了很多他的朋友跟他的一些朋友的太太等等。然后我想把他跟那个历史上面那个方孝孺做一个结合，写这种因为自己的某种理想主义而害得身边的人万劫不复的这样一种知识分子形象。 我首同学的困境是因为我看了大量的书，然后等到我认为看了一年的材料以后，完全准备好的时候，发现心力不够。我不知道大家其他同学有没有这种感受，就是你上了一年级以后，哪怕你写一个长篇，或者说哪怕你写一个你知道是一个非常重大的题材，你没有做好准备的情况下，你就是有畏惧感。然后很抱歉，我被打垮了，就是我到现在。 这一篇没有写出来，我之前写了楚安平，写了老舍，写了丁玲，但是写到这个，就是被打垮了，就是没有办法写下去。所以如果说我能够有一天重新写这个的话，也是因为我可能有另外一种方式去能够解读他们，而不是说我跟他们有一种居高临下的眼光去评判，因为你在写作的时候，你会发现你没有资格评判，你在那个历史环境下面，你不会做比他们更好，大概是这样吧。
So the challenge I've met is that when I was trying to write some kind of story, and the story is focused on a man called Hu Feng, the theme, and the story is basically the fate of the intellectuals in the period of Yan'an. I wanted to combine the intellectual's fate with the fate of some historical figures. And that man, Hu Feng, is a poet, and he wrote a poem. And this poem has made some bad effects and has brought harm to his friends and wife and the friends' wives. And I wanted to connect him with a historical figure called Fang Xiaolu. And the meaning is that someone's ideals has brought some harm to the people that is around them and this kind of dilemma. And I spent a year reading kind of documents and the books and the records, but after 1 year reading, I felt I'm not ready. I don't have this energy in my heart. I don't know if you have this kind of feeling when you are going to write a long story, long novel, or some big themes, whatever you have read, but if you haven't been ready in your heart, then you have this fear, and this fear will stop you from writing. I have written many people like Chuan Ping, Lao Shi, and Ding Ling. I can't write this because this kind of fear has stopped me and sometimes to some degree destroyed me. I think if I will rewrite this story, then I will write it from another perspective.
Xiao Bai, is there a anything that you've come across either creatively or practically speaking in your life as a writer that has caused you to question?
那小白在你的生活中，你在你的写作历程中，是不是也碰到过一些困难，让你在写作中对自己有所怀疑，或者发生出一些问题？
每天都是困难，对吧？但是我觉得就怎么看吧，如果你说困难、挑战，那每天都是困难，每天都是挑战。但你从另外一个角度来说呢，你每天都在做一个游戏，也是很开心的一件事情。就是那个，我其实我的方法是这样的，我是会有很多题。 就在电脑上，桌面上会有好几个题目，包括泽泽有以前是我的编辑，我也两个小时在这里面编，所以他，我经常跟他聊，那个时候我经常，当然现在他不干这件事儿，以前我经常跟他聊，哎，我有什么一个题目想写，过两天我又跟他说我有什么题目想写，因为我就一直有好多好多这样的题目，我到现在为止还有七八个题目在我的桌面上，每个题目已经有的写了七八千个字，有的写了几万个字。 但都扔在那边，已经完成的小说，几乎每一部小说都扔掉了。我租借我写了25000字，现在扔了7-8万字，举点也大概扔了5-6万字。然后哪怕是一个短文章，以前给专栏写的那个7-8千字的5000字的小说，也得扔掉几千字。就是我那个就是很多题目同时，然后我每天早上起来我就挑一个，今天挑个游戏玩，然后给挑一个。 玩了半天，玩不下去了，我就扔掉再玩。每天都在跟自己玩这样一个游戏，然后哎，就是几乎是每天会碰到，又这样搞，把家具搞得换一个视角啊，重新推翻重来啊，换一个人称啊，或者我换一个结构啊，或者整个大调都把后面往前面倒啊，就一直在做这样一些事情，做了很多很多的。
用的浪费的功夫，但实际上呢，这个过程也是一个游戏的过程。我心态，像我的心态是，我觉得这是玩一个很有趣的游戏，因为一件事情，一个事件，写作实际上语言是一个语言事件，你去把一件事情怎么讲清楚。因为我有一个基本的宗旨，就是我想用最少的话来把一个事件讲清楚，然后把一个事件里面最多的可能性，最多的。
意思讲清楚，当然这是我的对文字的一个基本的想法，所以我会不断去尝试，换一个视角，换个人物，几个人物，让他来从他的视角出发会怎么样，从他的视角出发会怎么样。他每这样的一个游戏，每天都是一个挑战，每天都会碰到问题，所以我十七八个题目走到现在，大概也只出来3-5题，还有一些题目在睡在那边，可能慢慢的会走出来，也可能。
I'll talk about difficulties and hardship or challenges. I think you face these challenges every day, but how do you solve them? And I think for me, these challenges, these hardships or difficulties, they are like a bad game for me every day. And I have a method to deal with them. My method is that I have as many things on my desktop, on my computer, and Zou Zou, he was my editor, and she has edited two of my novels. And before I would tell them one day that I want to write this scene, and the other day I would tell her that I want to write this scene. So I have many themes in my mind and on my desktop. For example, now I have 7-8 themes on my desktop, and each of them I like write 7,000-8,000 characters, and some of them I have written like 10,000 characters, but none of them are finished. And when I wrote novels, I always get rid of many of the characters. I deleted them. I would not use them. Like in the book Zuji, I have given up like 70,000 to 80,000 characters. And in the other novel, I have given up like 50,000 or 60,000 characters. And even some very short stories, I have deleted like 5,000 or 7,000 characters. So this is my game, and I think it's a very interesting game that I play every day. And when I'm faced with this challenge, or the difficulties, I would think to write it the other way. Like when I was writing a novel and I couldn't continue, then I would change another novel, change another theme to write. And I would think that, would I have another perspective? Or I would change another personified way to write it, or I would restruct it, or take another order of narrative to write it. I would always come up with methods to play this game. And my view on writing that I would try to use as few words as I can to explain the thing very clear. And I would add more possibilities as I can, and more meanings as I can to present the story I want to tell. And sometimes I will try if this person, he does not take this perspective. And in writing novel, I do not want to take this person's perspective. I would take the other person's perspective, or another third person's perspective, and how would the story develop? So my intention is to say that you are faced with challenges and difficulties every day. But for me, like the 7 to 8 novels on the thesis themes on my desktop, only 3 to 5 now is finished. And the rest, some of them they may develop into a whole novel, a whole story, and some of them they may like end, have no end. But that's the day, and that's the daily game I played.
Thank you. Since you brought up the distinction between the body of work and the career of writing, I'm maybe going to steer a little more specifically with you and ask if you wouldn't mind, you made it a choice to move from teaching to being a full-time writer. Have you ever had a moment where you questioned that or thought that was a mistake?
那首先我这边有一个问题，就是你刚刚谈到了工作的主体以及你写作这个职业这两个问题，那你也谈到你放弃了教书这个职业，然后变成了一个自由的作家。那么在这里呢，我的问题就是，当你在做出这个选择的时候，你是否有一刻怀疑过自己的选择
？I feel that there are very good things that come with this possibility of living, of make a living out of my writing. It's a privilege, but of course, there is also another side to it. There is always another side to everything. There is nothing that is fully perfect. And I think it was Oscar Wilde who said, maybe it was not Oscar Wilde, but somebody said that one has to be careful what one desires, because it may come true, you know. And that's also the case with writing. Of course, there are some darker aspects to it.
那我觉得写作它可以是一件比较好的事情，那它有一个比较好的方面，就是如果能从写作中挣钱的话。 当然，写作也有另外一个方面，就像万事万物都有两面，没有事情是完美的。奥斯卡·瓦尔德也是不是奥斯卡·瓦尔德，反正有人这样说过，他说你要小心你的欲望，因为你的欲望有一天会变成真的。那当然，写作也是这样，写作它也有它不好的一面。But
I try to focus on the positive side because nobody is forcing me to be a writer, I would say that probably among the positive aspects of it, there is some sort of freedom that exists in writing, and also this big privilege of observing life, of reflecting. I think that in a certain way, you feel, or I get to feel that I live life more fully than if I was not paying so much attention to it.
那我觉得生活写作它有非常好的一面。那因为没有什么人来逼我当作家，我是自愿当作家的，所以当我做出这个选择的时候，我会很多的观察到写作这个好的方面。比如说，当一个作家是非常自由的，你可以写出你想写的东西。 而更多的还有，你可以有更多的自由去观察生活，并且去反映生活。那我觉得我这种生活的方式其实是更加完满的。
如果说我没有写作，没有那么多观察生活的话，那我的生活也不会那么的完满。
But very briefly, I would like to add that from my perspective, writing has always to be a challenge. There is always, you have to put always some effort on it so that you feel that you achieved something, that you are not a fraud. Because if you keep on doing what you already know how to do, that's how you will feel after a while. And personally, the challenges that I put myself with writing are always on the first level, personal. I always try to put myself personally in an uncomfortable position. And then to write is a way of managing my way out of that uncomfortable position. About 2 years ago, I think I was in Macau, and a friend of mine was working at the bungee jumping at the Tower of Macau, Portuguese friend of mine. And he told me, you have to jump. Since you're here in Macau, you have to jump. And I said, of course I'll jump. I said it very, I made that decision very fast, but then the time that took me until the moment that I jumped, I was very anxious and nervous about that, because it's 250 meters high, and it's like all, you have Macau in front of you, all the buildings, and you jump. And that's a bit how I see the period of writing. I mean, I decide that I'm going to do something that I consider very risky, and then I feel very sick in my stomach, I throw up, I'm very reactive to everybody around me, I'm not a very good company, I don't sleep, it's bad for my health, I lose air. But the big thing and the big realization is when I manage to get out of that, and then I'm fully, I reach a level of contentment that I don't get with anything else.
那简单的说到，我觉得写作中它是会碰到挑战的，然后这样一个挑战呢，你一定要去用力去克服它，因为不管你想获得什么东西，你都要付出努力去得到它。如果你不付出努力，你一直在做你已经知道怎么做的事情，那你就会感觉到这样一个成果是很假的。那在我的个人写作中，我的挑战就是我会感到非常的不舒服，那我所付出的努力去克服它，也就是我去摆脱这种不舒服。那举一个例子，2年前呢，我去澳门，然后我的朋友告诉我在澳门有一个蹦极塔，你来澳门一定要蹦极。那我当时就很轻易地回答他，当然我会去。我很轻易地就做出了这样一个决定，很快地做出了这样一个决定。但是当我真的要去跳的时候呢，我发现我非常的紧张，非常的焦虑。毕竟那个塔有250米高，而你在前面就能看到所有的澳门的建筑。你往下看的时候，然后你要向那个建筑上面跳，是非常的紧。非常的紧张的。那我的写作过程其实也是这样的，当我做出一个有着风险的决定的时候呢，我和胃里会感觉不舒服，我会反胃，而我也会变成一个比较难相处的人，我对我的朋友都变得不怎么友好，我睡不着，我开始脱发。但是当我付出所有的努力去摆脱这种困境的时候呢，我所获得的满足感是另外其他任何事情都不会带给我的。
Aleš, you get to wrap up for us. And I think if it's okay for me to also be a little more specific with you, you intrigued me with your talk of approaching the language of literature as a foreigner, discovering the new language as you write it. That must be exhausting. Is there a time that you felt like walking away from that, or do you maybe take the energy to continue on with it, or?
Actually, it would be a paraphrase of what was already said.
Well, 我对 Aleš 想问一个更加细致的一个问题，因为呢，我看到过你的那么多的诗集，那么多的文学作品，你在文学上如此的卓著丰硕，那么你一定对他们投入了非常多的努力。那是否有这么样一个时刻，你感觉到非常的累，你想我再也不要写作了？
Why trying to do the possible? The possible is boring. One, as a writer, as an artist, one has to try the impossible.
为什么你只做可能做到的事情呢？所有可能做到的事情都是很无聊的。作为一个艺术家，作为一个作家，你应该尝试一些不可能的事情。
Perhaps from an outsider's perspective, the impossible for someone doesn't seem impossible. But I firmly believe that the psychological invention, we've heard about fear and we've heard about challenge, is being felt in language. Language cannot be tricked. Language is absolutely truthful. It shows everything to the reader, to the sensitive reader.
那在几局外人眼中看来呢，可能有一些不可能的事情其实看起来是可能的，但是我们刚刚提到的不管是害怕还是这些挑战，它在语言的表达中其实都是真实存在的。语言它是不会欺骗人的，语言它是真实的。
There is always the notion of seeking for a language for a certain piece or work that is deeply connected with writingI have to invent, but on the same hand, I have to forget or negate everything that I've done so far.
那在语言中呢，这个语言它总是和作品，各种各样的作品联系起来的。那在我的创作过程中，我总是要不断去忘记一些东西，去否定一些东西。
Sometimes this can drive you completely mad. For example, I've written a book about Peru and Cesar Vallejo.And I had the book, and it should be published, but I could not find an appropriate title. It was just this last piece that was needed, but I couldn't find it. So I got already completely mad and nervous, and all the suggestions of editors were not helping me either.
那这样一种过程呢，有时候会让你变得很疯狂。那比如说呢，我有一本书，然后这本书呢其实已经快要完成了，但它总是有最后的一点，最后的一个拼图的缺片，好像填不上去。我向我的很多的编辑朋友们寻找建议，但是这没有用。
So I went to the Frankfurt Book Fair, which is the biggest book fair on the planet, and you go and there are millions of books published only in the last year, and it's a shock for each writer because you go there and you think, whatI am writing too, among all these millions. What sense does it have?
那我之前呢去过法兰克福书展，它是世界上最大的一个书展。那你会看到前一年有上百万册的书出版了。这对于每一个作者来说，对每一位作家来说，都是一件震惊的事情。你会想什么？我在那么几百万的作者中也在写书，那这有什么意义呢？
I was feeling confused and lost, and I was wandering around.And then I took the electric stairway, and when it was lifting me, and I could see further and further up all the books beneath me, the title came like that.
那这个时候呢，我是困惑的，我是迷失的。接下来我会往前走，然后我就坐了一个电车。当我一边往上坐的时候呢，我就发现那些书的名字就变得越来越小，越来越小。
But there is another, I will be very brief, there, another example, there is a novel of solution, and it's a novel about how to live with very traumatic past, with mass executions in contemporary world, in Europe, how to go on as society, the impossibility to live with a traumatic past, basically. And I was trying to write this book for years, and I had images, but they didn't leaveTogether, and then came as a click again that the novel is already written. It was like 20 centimeters above my head, and I had only to focus on that point, and then I could very easily write it. But it was this trick that it took me a couple of years to to find the trick.
那么另外一个例子呢，就是我们在写作的时候，我们如何去面临欧洲这样一个充满伤痛的过去。那么有那么几年呢，我会花几年的时间去拼凑我脑海里的这样一个小说的情节。那么会有那么一瞬间，就好像咔嗒一声，这样所有的情节都已经拼好了，所有的拼图都已经完整了，整个小说都就好像漂浮在我头上20英里左右的地方，突然间一切都变得很容易了。但就是这样一个咔嗒的这样一个瞬间，却需要我花几年的时间去寻找。
My third and last example of how to confront the impossibility, and I think it corresponds with what was said by colleague Bai.
那我最后一个例子，我的也是我的第三个例子，就是我的写作的某种可能性。这个例子它是和小白刚刚所说的一件事情相连的。
The Slovenian philosopher Slavoj Žižek was asked once, and he's a very prolific writer, he writes numerous books a year. He was asked, I mean, what do you think about writing? He said, I have absolute fear from writing. But so I never write, basically. I only take notes. And then I see, oh, I've taken 500 pages of notes, and then I start editing.So I edit and edit, and there is the book, and I have never written it.
那这个例子呢，就是前苏联有这么一个哲学家，这样一个作家，他是一个卓著丰硕的这样一个人。然后呢，他每一年都会写无数本书，但是他说的是，我非常害怕写作。然后呢，我从来都不写作，我只记笔记。当我记了足够多的500页的笔记的之后呢，我就开始编辑它。然后呢，一本书就诞生了，但是我并没有去写它。
I think it's appropriate that we end on a note of inspiration. I love that. I'm going to start writing all my books that way. let's see if we have met. Yeah, we have about 15 minutes for questions. So if anyone has a question for the entire panel or for an individual writer, we'd be happy for you to take the mic and let us know what you're thinking.
我觉得刚刚的他的那种写作方式是一种很好的收集灵感的方式，我从来没有这样写作过。那么接下来呢，我们还有15分钟的时间，不管大家对这四位作家有意见，还是这有问题，还是对这四位作家中的其中一位有问题，都可以提出来。
This is a question for all of you. Do you think you need to be in some special condition to write? I mean, for instance, alone, of course, I guess, and in a place, always in one place. You cannot, for instance, be traveling somewhere and writing. You have to be at home, or you need to be in an environment you know very well. You cannot be some.What are the conditions for interview to be in a good mood to write?
那我的问题呢是对这四位作家提出的，就是你们的写作是否有一种特定的环境去促使，需要某种特定的环境去写作？比如说，有的人他必须在家里才能写作，有的人他必须在旅行中才会有这种灵感。你们会不会需要这样一种环境带给你们某一种情绪去写作？
When I was starting to write, I thought I would need a complete peace and my writing room, you know, Virginia Woolf, all the stories, yeah, we've learned it. Then my wife moved to England and I was commuting a lot. So I was flying twice, three times a month to England. So I was spending a lot of time on airports. And I started to write on airports. I found it as a relief, these non-places. And so gradually, basically, I taught myself to write anywhere, in any circumstances, under any condition, in crowds or by myself. So I don't care anymore. But it needed time to get here.
那我呢，之前写作需要绝对的安静，我需要有我自己的一个书房，就像弗吉尼亚·伍尔夫写过的书一样。书里提到的一样，但是后来呢，我的妻子她搬去了英国，然后呢，我的生活就变了。我需要每个月飞2到3次去英国，然后我会花很多的时间在机场里， 那我就开始在机场里写作了。我发现这对我来说是一种安慰。我开始渐渐地能够在任何的环境中写作，不管有很多的人还是只有我自己。我觉得这是一个很好的方式，当然这需要时间。
Would anyone else like to take a stab at
that? 我觉得我就是没有别的要求，就是要亮一点，所以我基本上是在窗口或者那个还不够亮的话，我就到舞台上，我们加一个露台。就有时候有电脑屏幕有问题，因为反光太强烈，所以这个平衡是一个怎么样，既不反光又要保持足够的亮度，对我来说是一个挑战。其他我没有反，没有什么。还有一个就是对地方特别挑剔的时候，往往就是刚才前一个问题聊的，非常纠结，不知道怎么下手，尝试各种可能性，但还找不到出路的时候。那一旦找到出路了，在哪都可以行。在火车上、飞机上，到底可以行？就其实跟你的心理是有关系。
For me, I don't have the other requirements. I only want the place to be very bright. So I usually write by the window. And if by the window it's not bright enough, I will move to the terrace. At my home, there's a terrace. But there is a problem with the screen, because sometimes in a place where it's too bright, then the screen will show the reflections. So it's a challenge, kind of challenge for me to find the balance between the screen and the brightness.And sometimes I will write, and I think when I can't write well, when I find fault with the place, then it's usually the time that I can find the thought for the novel. So it's kind of psychologically, because when you have the thoughts, when you know how to write, then every place you can write.
Okay, I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions before we hit our time limit. Does anyone else have something you'd like to ask our authors?
I want to ask the question, Zou Zou, hello. I was very interested in the question you just mentioned, which was very interesting. I was very surprised by the question.就是您提到了，就是文学的叙事，如果用语言去来分析的话，最后把整个文学叙事体力的一个结构，就是范式到彻底结构以后，个人的叙事性，也就是个人性，在叙事之间就等于完全是消解了。对于这个理论是就是感觉非常的受到冲击。那么我想请问一下，如果您有没有想过，如果照您的这个理论继续发展下去的话，那么我们就是在写作过程中，未来写作过程中。如果真的做到了个人性的完全消解的话，那么文学的叙事的重点将会放在哪里呢？
So my question is for Zou Zou. I am touched and shocked by the theory you just mentioned, the theory of the literature narrative and the structure of the narrative. Since you have found the structure, then the individuality has totally resolved. So if this kind of tendency has developedAnd this theory has developed, and in the process of writing, all the individuality has been resolved. Then where is the focus of the narrative of literature?
我补充一下，我刚才说的那个结论是针对经典文学的，是好作品的。但是我们也扫了几百部、几百万字的网文，有两个趋势，一种是直线向上，一种是直线向下。对，就是爽文跟不爽黑暗文。回到你刚才那个问题，我一直在想这个问题。我们现在是把所有的小说中的每一个我们说桥段吧，把它赋值。也就是说，在任何的文学作品中，在最绝望的那个瞬间，你要采取一个行动。就比如讲，我们看到一些小说，在一种非常压抑的情况下，你突然在大庭广众下面裸舞，你突然打了一枪，你突然砸碎了一个什么东西，所有这东西的本质是一样的。现在计算机是可以把所有的这些本质的东西可以赋值，赋值之后，我在想，就是说，首先我们尝试了一下，计算机未来十年内最能够写出来的作品是什么？是那些语言风格极为强烈的作者，他是最容易模仿的。我们试下来的结果，村上春树是很容易模仿。我是说中文的翻译题啊，不说日文，我们现在只能解决中文跟英文，日语还不行。然后是一种 玩弄技巧的。我们之前认为的文本实验，不管是拼贴性质的，事实上也就是说一个纳博科夫的低配版是很容易达到的，它不断的炫技，它不断的拼贴各种知识，这个是人工智能最容易完成的。那么最难完成的是什么？我认为是一种完全抽离感情的。我现在想的，因为你刚刚那问题启发了我，就是我一直在想说我以后要写个作品就要挑战人工智能，我想的是一个圆圈的一个循环线，这种结构的作品到今天没有一部作品产生过。所以我最后是想说，当我们已经知道所有的描述的事件背后都有值的时候，我是不是可以用一个均衡的值，比如说都是十，全部来复制，把这样的一个东西拼贴出来的这样的一个小说作为一个螺旋性，有没有可能？我很感谢你，因为我之前没有想过，是你这个问题问到的时候我想到了，因为我一直很想挑战人工智能。我认为人工智能能写出来的小说大家就没有必要再写。我们要挑战的是什么？真的是人我们自己的喜怒哀乐吗？不是，我觉得真正要挑战的是一种结构，建筑里面有很多的结构是之前我们没有见过的，非均衡的、倾斜的、威胁的结构，小说中没有。我觉得这个很有意思，谢谢。
When I mentioned that theory, I mean the theory for the classical works, the good works. We have also tested some net literature, that's the literature on the internet written by those not so good writers, and they are linear. There are also two kinds of models. The first model is linear upward, and the other model is linear downward. Then first one shows happiness and the second one shows sadness. And we also found some plots that's very easy to copy. That is when someone faces desperation, they must take some action. Like for example, the action of dancing naked in front of public or just a shoot. The essence is very easy to copy. Every computer can copy. So 10 years later, if the artificial intelligence can write something, what the work will be? And I think the most easy work to copy is the works with very strong language styles, like the work of a very famous Japanese writer that's translated like Chen Shang Chen Shu in Chinese. I mean the translated version of his work, not the Japanese version. And the other one is the works with very strong techniques, like sometimes you just scramble them together. Like if you want to write a low-scale version of Nabokov's works, it's very easy done by artificial intelligence. And what's the hardest work to copy by artificial intelligence? That's the works without emotions. And when you ask the question, I have been inspired by you. And I think the challenge for artificial intelligence shall be the structure of a cycle that is will be a closed loop. And this kind of work is very hard to write because it's not easy for you to scramble together the logic. So in my opinion, I think if the works that artificial intelligence can write them, then we human beings don't need to write them. We only need to write the things that artificial intelligence cannot write. This is a challenge that we human writers are faced with.
Okay, I think, Zou, thank you for closing up. I think we are out of time now. Thank you so much to all of our panelists. It was a wonderful conversation. I'm glad that I got to be here to listen to it, and I'm sure that you all are as well. And please, everybody, give a hand to our wonderful translator, Rebecca. I don't know how she does it.
I think we're
just out of time.
非常快，很快。
Okay, one very quick question.
很快，因为这个时间比较紧急，所以我本来是想知道各位的答案，但是我现在就是想问这个左起第四位，对。 对，做七七四位这位是这样，我是想快速的向您确认几个问题，因为我觉得您的很像中国的一句话，我觉得您身上有我喜欢的东西，我觉得您很像中国的以四个字叫赤子之心。我是想问您三个问题，您这个方便吗？很简短。第一个问题是，您在写作的时候是否会有一些需要像这个咖啡或者茶这样的一些辅助的，就是帮助您获得灵感的这样的一些东西？
Okay, well, we are going to end the conversation about coffee and tea, and we're waiting with bated breath.
您只需要回答，什么需要，是还是不是？
Yes or no?
Yes or no?
Yes or no? More than coffee or tea, I think sleep helps. lots of sleep.
那个第二个，您更习惯是用纸质的写，还是用一些电子设备？
Well, I think it's very good to interchange.To do one and then to do it in the so either computer or handwritten, and then you change and then you do the same in the other, because there is a certain kind of distance produced through it.
Okay, thank you for closing up for us and to our last questioner. And I think that we are truly out of time at this point, so we are going to go get some sleep so we can all write well tomorrow. Okay, thank you, everybody.